It's time to take y'all on a trip to the past in more ways than one. What you're about to watch is a video that I was working on last May. It was supposed to be about the way that women are portrayed in the anime of 1991, for reasons that I'll get into once the video starts. Now, I had originally planned to write a video about this, but at the time, it didn't seem right. I couldn't figure out how to write it well. I tried a bunch of different ways, and eventually I decided I would just talk about it unscripted, which back then was not something I did a lot of. So, I recorded this unscripted vlog, edited it down. It was about 35 minutes long, and I thought at the time that it wouldn't really be justified to make a full video out of it unless I could put footage over it. So I was going to take footage from all the shows I talk about and put it on screen and show all these examples and stuff, because I wanted to show examples of the things I was talking about. And basically, I just didn't think anyone would really care about it, or that the point I was making didn't really amount to anything. It was just kind of a bunch of observations about the way that this thing happened at this time in anime history. And the prospect of trying to get all that editing done was just more than I felt like doing. I had to re-download most of the shows, and I didn't want to do that, and edit it together. So just, it never got done. It's just been sitting on my computer all this time, this unfinished project. And now that I do vlogs regularly, I don't see much reason to hold on to it anymore, because I'm obviously never going to fully edit this thing the way I originally envisioned. So, I'm just going to throw the project out there. You guys can look at what it was and finally get it off my plate. So this train of thought might be a little bit difficult to follow. It all starts with me making the totally random decision to watch every anime released in 1991, because that's the year that I was born, and I wanted to make a top 10 anime of 1991 list in the interest of eventually making a top 10 list for every year of anime history. So I start watching these 1991 shows, and right off the bat, the first thing I watch is like a softcore porn, because I just wanted to get it out of the way quick. And it was called Dragon Something, I'll put the name up on screen. And it's about this guy who's going and he's like rescuing all these girls from like these sexual situations, but then right after rescuing them, immediately molests them himself. Like, he's worse than the people he's saving them from, right? And I was just kind of like, oh, God, what is this shit, right? So I'm watching this, and I'm thinking, this feels very 90s anime, softcore porn kind of thing, right? The second show I watch is called Hoshikuzu Paradise, I believe. It's about this kid who ends up with this family that's like this rich, famous family, and he ends up being like adopted into them essentially. And he has this sister who's an idol. This show was the most generic possible, like, harem comedy show. Like, it could have come out today and you'd immediately think that it was normal. It was only one episode, I believe. But it's this kid keeps walking in on his sister when she's changing clothes, and she slaps him and that kind of thing. And then there's like all these people are trying to like basically perv on her or like get her attention and stuff like that. And I was just like, whatever, it's a generic show. So then the next show I watch, this is where we start to recognize a trend. I'm watching this show called Slow Step. It's a 5-episode OVA adapted from a shoujo manga by Mitsuru Adachi, who is an incredibly famous manga author. He wrote Touch and Cross Game, which are both huge franchises from the 80s, and I think Cross Game's from the 2000s, though. But he was a really big name, especially for Touch, writing these high school rom-coms with sports angles. They're always about people playing baseball. Like, that's his thing. So in Cross Game, and not Cross Game, in Slow Step, the main character is a girl, because it's a shoujo manga, but she still plays baseball, and she's like the ace of the baseball team. So in this show, the first episode starts off with the main girl witnessing a crime. She sees a hit and run. And later on, she's reporting this hit and run, and the people who performed it overhear her. And so they try to, like, get her, like, to silence her. And she's on the roof of her apartment building, and they basically, like, gang up on her, and it seems really rapey and skeevy, and I was just like, man, this is around the point where I start thinking, 1991 was a terrible time to be a female in anime. Like, the women are all being treated horribly, they're all at risk of perversion or being raped and stuff like that, and throughout this show, like, the main character girl, like, she'll be, like, leaving the house, and her parents are like, yeah, make sure you don't get raped, basically, like, just leaving the house. And the thing about Slow Step is that this is more or less a realistic show. It's going for, like, a contemporary setting, like, it's supposed to just be Japan in the 90s kind of thing, or late 80s, rather. So, this feels like a realistic portrayal of what this girl would be experiencing as a high school girl. The show's about this girl having three guys who are all interested in her. One is a classmate she's known for a long time who's constantly asking her out on dates. And she's not really interested in him. Then there's this guy who's, like, kind of a weird idiot, but also kind of a badass, and he's a boxer. He falls in love with her while she's in disguise as another person, and he wants her. Eventually, he finds out who the real her is, and these two guys are fighting over her. Then there's her coach, her baseball coach, who's a total pervert, and he constantly is fucking sneaking peeks at all the girls in the school. He's just a weirdo, and he's gross, right? And if you're watching this today, from a modern American perspective, your first thought is, why hasn't this guy been arrested? This guy is a terrible, terrible man. But he's also interested in the main girl. And as the story goes on, at first you don't really take him seriously as a love interest, but eventually you realize that he is meant to be taken seriously as a love interest. And these three guys are all hounding over this girl. Well, here's where the paradigm shift comes in. Because all this time I'm thinking about how much it sucks to be a girl in 90s anime. Except she totally rejects these guys at every turn. She's telling them, like, I don't want to be fought over, I don't want any of you, I'm just not interested, I don't have feelings for you. And these guys will do all this hyper-masculine stuff, they'll be like, oh, we're gonna get into a boxing match, and whoever wins gets the girl, and then the boxing match ends, and she's like, I never asked for this, I don't want either of you. And she kind of has reasons to like each of them, but they're not tied to, like sexual reasons or anything. It's not because she just finds them attractive, they have good points about their personalities. And she is like a saint when it comes to appreciating these guys, like, for their good qualities. Like, she's willing to look past how much of complete assholes these guys all are, fighting over her and making fools of themselves. And she's just, like, totally, like, I mean, she beats them up every now and then, but she seems pretty cool about it and is constantly, like, appreciating their good points, and I was almost baffled by it. But she has this almost saintly demeanor in dealing with these guys. And towards the end, you get to a point where she starts to feel attracted to one of them because he's changing, because he's getting his life together. He stops being as much of chasing after her. And the reasons that she ends up liking him have nothing to do with him trying to get her affection. It has to do with how he's picking himself up and getting his life turned around. But it's subtle. It doesn't outright say, oh, she's now in love with him or anything like that. There's a great scene in the third episode where the coach comes over to the main girl's house. And he's, like, making demands of her to do all these things that, like, a wife would do, right? Like, to bring him some tea and all this stuff. And she's totally failing at all of it. And he's just kind of, like, opening up his eyes to the fact that, wow, she wouldn't really be the wife I want her to be. Like, he expects that just because he has her, she's going to be a great wife. But she doesn't really have any of those qualities, those typical feminine qualities that he's looking for. And he doesn't quite grasp that, and she's just like, look, I'm not gonna act that way, that's not me. She's just always true to herself, always acting exactly on her own desires. And the end of this anime is a little bit disappointing, because the original manga that it's based on ends with her not hooking up with any of the three guys. It kind of hints at which one she's gonna end up with. It shows her developing affections towards him. But she just kind of says, maybe I'll end up there in the future, and it ends. Whereas the anime, at the very last second, like the last 30 seconds of the show, after the credits, it shows her getting married to him. Like, it shows their wedding. And I just thought it kind of cheapened the message a little bit to say that she definitely ended up with that guy, as opposed to just suggesting that maybe if you have some good traits, maybe girls will actually like you, and not just because you think that they should or you believe that they belong to you, as these guys kind of thought that she did. In the end, she rejects them all and she makes a choice based on her own feelings. So I thought that was cool. And at the same time that I'm watching this show, I start watching other shows. I was watching a lot of stuff at once, and I see one called Ozanari Dungeon, where it's about just some girl kicking ass. Like, it was a fantasy show. She takes contracts to go, like, raid temples and stuff, and then she just kicks a bunch of people's ass and saves the day, and that's the story. There was also one called Maju Senshi Luna Varja. This one is about a girl who is a princess. She's one of three princesses, the middle child, and she unlocks a secret power to protect her kingdom, in which, the only way to put it is her crotch becomes Godzilla. That's the only way I can describe it. Her crotch becomes the brain of Godzilla. It's literally Godzilla. They don't say the name, but it looks like it's got the same theme music, it makes the same sound effects, it's fucking Godzilla. I don't know how to take that, metaphorically speaking, you know? Like, I don't know if that could be considered a positive, empowering message, or like a weird, the vagina is a giant, evil, terrifying lizard. But she saves her kingdom using her crotch Godzilla power, so I guess in the end she's a strong female character. So as I'm going through these shows, what I slowly start to realize is that even though these women find themselves in these dangerous situations where maybe they're, you know, being assaulted by someone, or more often they're just being made fun of for being women. Like in Luna Varga, the guy's like, oh, a little girl thinks she can defeat me, and then she kicks his ass. And that's generally what always happens. The girl always kicks everyone's ass, makes all the decisions, saves the day. And that's a little unusual for anime, because anime does have a lot of strong female characters. It has a lot of girls who kick ass and take names, and they always have the magical powers. They're always the ones with the swords and stuff like that. But there's always a guy protagonist who they end up needing, especially in a lot of modern shows. There's always the main guy who's, he's just some schlubby normal dude, and all these powerful girls end up somehow they're just there to boost him up, to make him look more cool, because, you know, either they emotionally rely on him or he comes through to save the day. And that's very typical. And there are some shows like that from 1991, but all the ones I saw were like hyper masculine shows. Ninja Gaiden, a show about a fucking burly ninja who goes around murdering people, and he saves the girl in the end. Cyber City Oedo 808, which is from the creator of Ninja Scroll, which is basically a cyberpunk ninja show. So anything that had ninjas, the ninjas were usually badass guys saving some girl. These shows are obviously made for, you know, the macho guy audience. And there's a few more like that, but they were so rare compared to just how many OVAs there were about just girls kicking ass. Women kicking ass. And, for instance, Bubblegum Crisis. The first episode is these four girls who take on fucking cyber power suits. We're talking like Kamen Rider suits. And how many times do you see that with a girl, first of all? There's plenty of transforming superheroes, but outside of magical girls, who only really started kicking ass as of Sailor Moon, arguably, and Pretty Cure, definitely. But magical girl shows from this era were typically not combat-oriented. But these girls put on fucking super suits and beat the shit out of bad guys, and they're fucking badass. And the first episode has them all, like, at, like, height of their career moments, where the one girl's trying to become an idol singer, and she just, like, got a contract deal, but then her producer's kind of, like, trying to hit on her, and they tell her they want her to wear a dress to go on stage, and she's like, fuck that, I'm not wearing a dress, I kick too much ass, and she goes off to kick ass somewhere. One of the girls was working for the police, one of them was a, like, real estate broker, or not real estate, stock broker. They were just, like, all these, in these, like, sort of powerful positions, and they kicked a lot of ass. And I just, that set the tone for me. And I know that Bubblegum Crash and Bubblegum Crisis were, like, sort of emblematic of this era of anime, this late 80s, early 90s period. And bear in mind that while I'm talking about shows from 1991, because that's the year I chose to cover, most of these started either in the late 80s or ran into 1992, 93. These shows either were based on manga from the 80s or ran a little bit longer, because most shows were either OVAs that ran over a couple of years, or they were long-running kids' shows that spanned like 50 episodes or more. So this was just the climate of late 80s, early 90s. But it wasn't like this before that much. There were kick-ass girls, but most shows were robot shows about dudes and spy shows about dudes, Lupin the Third running around, or Fist of the North Star, all these macho, badass guys. And it's really like, in the area of, like, 1988, we start seeing, like, Gunbuster, where it's this cool girl fucking piloting a robot, and we get Pat Labor, which is a robot show that ran from, I want to say, 1988 up through 1992 in various incarnations, and the main character is a girl who pilots the giant robot. And it's a very, like, low-tempo slice-of-life show, and it's never made a big deal that it's a girl piloting it. She just is the pilot. And you just don't get a lot of robot shows where the girl is the pilot. It doesn't happen a lot, but it happened in this period where everyone was girls. So one of the shows I watched is a sci-fi OVA called Soul Bianca, about, like, a group of five girls in a spaceship going around the universe, kicking ass. There's this great line in the first episode where one of the girls says something to the effect of, like, we're not going to be held down, all we care about is freedom, we just want to do whatever we want and stuff like that, while talking to this, like, patriarchal king dude who's trying to enslave them all as, like, his part of his collection or whatever. Which, all of this, by the way, reminds me a lot of the themes of Mad Max Fury Road, if you haven't seen that yet. There was a Ghibli movie in this particular year called Only Yesterday, which isn't so much about a girl kicking ass, but it is about a girl in her 30s reminiscing about different stories from her life, a lot of which involve her not having been feminine enough by social standards and people criticizing her for it, telling her that she was never going to be able to get married because she wasn't feminine enough. There's a whole sequence about the girls in elementary school learning about periods for the first time, and just boys just being complete assholes to them about having their period, like treating it like it's a disease and making fun of them for having it and stuff like that. And just all these general struggles of what it was like for her to be a girl throughout the 60s when she grew up, and as an adult now, where she's in her 30s and people are giving her shit about not getting married, and she's not sure if she's happy with her job. In the end, she does end up falling for a guy and wanting to get married to him, but it happens in a very natural sort of way. It didn't feel like the message was that she needed to get married, like the Princess and the Frog or something. Rogen Z, which is a film from the same director as Akira, was a movie about mostly a social commentary on the way that people treat old people, and it's a hilarious sort of dark comedy about the treatment of old people in modern society, but the main character is the caretaker of an old guy who gets swept up in this government conspiracy, and he has no idea what's going on. And she's just this cool, compassionate girl who's trying to save the old man. Very straightforward, very heroic. There's guys who are constantly trying to flirt with her, and she just completely ignores them, goes to the rescue of this old man. And the giant robot thing that, because the old man is in this bed that, like, eventually turns into, like, a big, grotesque Akira monster robot thing, but it's trying to protect the old man, and it has the spirit of his dead wife in it, or it's simulating her or something. It's a weird movie, but essentially the film is about these two women trying to save this old man from this government conspiracy. 3x3 Eyes, which I have on DVD behind me, is a show about a girl who is, like, got a split personality. Half is like an immortal demon creature thing, and the other half is just a fairly normal girl who's just very happy-go-lucky. And the demon thing gives the main guy his power. So it's sort of, the guy is sort of the main character, and he's usually the one doing the heroics, but all of his powers come from the girl, and she is way more powerful than him when she opens up her demon powers. She's, like, ridiculously strong. Tsukeban Deka is a 80s pulp, grimdark, weird, hilarious kind of series that was originally a manga that was most famously adapted into a live-action show, which was the biggest visual influence on Kill la Kill. If you've ever, If you're a fan of Kill la Kill, I highly encourage you to look into Sukeban Deka, because the homages it pays to it are ridiculous. But there was an anime version in 1991 where the main character is this girl she was in prison, and in order to get out, to save her mom from getting executed in prison or whatever, she has to, like, investigate crazy things happening at schools and stuff, and she has to kick all these other crazy girls' asses. One girl does get brutally sexually assaulted and murdered, but the main character girl is sort of out to avenge her. It's very much a story where most of the important characters are women, and the only guy there is sort of a sidekick to the main girl. Cleopatra DC is a much lighter take on a similar concept. This one's basically Girl Batman, where the main girl is the leader of the biggest financial conglomerate in the world. She's just ludicrously powerful, a completely wacky character and concept, mind. But, like, she's got all this money and she uses it to save people. She generally just, like, walks into situations where she tries to help someone, and it ends up being that there's some kind of crazy conspiracy behind it, but she uses her money and power to help save them. It's a weird and interesting show, but it is what it is. It's Girl Batman. Silent Mobius has girls who are fighting extraterrestrial terrors, and I honestly can't tell you too much because this was a really confusing movie that was not very good, but nonetheless, it was girls fighting alien demon things. Boken Ixer 3, sci-fi show, overpowered girls in space doing it. This one was also bad, and I didn't watch much of it, but it again, I'm just naming how many shows there were that were like this. Gulf Force New Era, part of a long franchise that went through the 80s about groups of girls who save the world from things. This one wasn't very good either, but I've been told the earlier ones are a little bit better. This one, I wouldn't even say the girls were really badasses, because it takes like 75% of the runtime for them to even get into the action. But nonetheless, all the important characters were young women. There's a lot of these shows with girls kicking ass, and I'm gonna admit, I do think a lot of this, or at least some of it, is definitely a sexual thing. It's definitely guys want to see girls kicking ass, usually in skimpy outfits, and there's a couple of shows that really show that. One of them is Devil Hunter Yoko, which is borderline porn, really, but it's like a girl who's she gains her powers from her virginity, like maintaining her virginity is why she still has powers. And she's, like, fighting demons as part of her bloodline thing. Her clothes always get torn off. She's always naked. And in the first episode, she's, like, raped, but, like, it's not taken seriously. It's, like, the guy, like, gets all the way up to penetration, and then, like, he gets lifted from the spell he's under, and she's just like, oh, I guess I'm okay, and he goes to fight demons. It was weird and very perverse. But it still is part of this trend. I'm not necessarily trying to make a point that these are all, like, feminist shows, or that they're all trying to promote, like, better attitudes about women necessarily. It's just that it's an interesting trend that there's so many shows about girls kicking ass. And even Devil Hunter Yoko, she is always the one kicking all the ass in the end. And it does have some great-looking fight scenes. The show is terrible, though. I don't recommend it. One that's not as defensible in that regard is Burn Up, which is also very clearly a show about girls kicking ass, but they're also hot, and they're also, you know, sometimes naked or promiscuous and stuff like that. And in this show, the girl has, like, her boyfriend doesn't want her fighting and stuff. He's always like, oh, you shouldn't go out on missions, you should just stay at home. And she's like, no, fuck that, I'm gonna go out. But, like, in the end, he still kind of saves her. So I wasn't sure if the show was trying to suggest that she should indeed stay at home or not. It was really odd, and I couldn't put my finger on it. But, so again, not necessarily saying that all these girls are just purely strong, independent symbols of what all women should be and stuff like that. I mean, in anyways, that's all debatable, and I'm not going to take a political stance on that anyways. I'm just saying that these girls were kicking ass in these shows, and there's a fucking huge list here of kick-ass girls. Even in shows where the girls weren't necessarily the main characters. Nadia, the Secret of Blue Water, I would say she sort of plays second fiddle to Jean, the male lead, and the two of them save each other sort of regularly. It's a romance adventure, a lot like Eureka 7, if you've ever seen that, where the two characters are always sort of in limbo of saving each other, falling in love by the end. And to an even lesser extent, the girl from Arslan Senki, the heroic legend of Arslan, which has a currently running anime adaptation, but the first episode of the original adaptation was in 1991. And in that show, there's only one female character who joins the team, but she is an unbelievable badass. She's, like, introduced as just this incredibly awesome, crazy... She's sort of like Brienne of Tull from Game of Thrones, just like this fucking hard-ass, kick-ass girl. Of course, unlike Brienne, she's incredibly beautiful as well, but this is anime, and it's Arslan, and everyone's beautiful, so of course she's beautiful, but she kicks a ton of ass. One that I found particularly interesting was The Sensualist. This is a weird, hour-long art porn, I guess? It's definitely, like, it's definitely not for kids. It's super racy. It has sex in it, but it tries to be very artistic about it, and it takes place during, like, the Meiji era or something like that. And it's part historical fiction about this guy who slept with, like, 3,000 women in his life, and partly telling the story of this dude who makes a bet that he can sleep with the most famous courtesan in Japan within the span of 1 week, and if he loses, he gets his dick cut off. And what's great about this story is that the courtesan woman, she actually is, like, has all the power in this story. It's all up to her whether or not she wants to have sex with this guy. And she's presented as, like, this unbelievable, like, godly figure in the story. Like, she makes all the has all the power over this guy's destiny. And she does have sex with him just because she feels sorry for him, because she could tell by looking at him that he probably lost a bet to end up there, and that's why she ends up having sex with him to save him from getting his dick cut off. So I thought that was pretty interesting, kind of empowering in a weird-ass backwards way. Ushiro no Shomen Dare is a World War II drama about a little girl whose entire fucking family dies in the course of the movie, but the beginning part also comments of similarly to Only Yesterday, where the characters are always telling her that she's not going to be marriageable because she's not girly enough. That plot line kind of just doesn't matter anymore once all of her family dies, but whatever, it's a show about a girl surviving, I guess. And then even notwithstanding all these shows where the girls either kick ass and take names or are made fun of for being women and then, you know, get their revenge and stuff like that. And there are some, like I said, there are some shows where the women aren't really badass and they still face these kinds of issues. I would say Mobile Suit Gundam 0083 Stardust Memories, there's, like, a really pervy guy who's always hitting on all the girls, and the girls definitely hold their own in the show, but they're not the main characters and they're not that interesting. But even in shows where the girls aren't necessarily super badasses, there were a ton of shows just with female characters, female leads around this era. We have shoujo stuff like Goldfish Warning, which is a super adorable and really funny, like, kids show that's just about, like, just happens to be the main characters are girls. Lika-chan no Fushigi na Maho, which is about, like, the Japanese equivalent of, like, a Barbie doll movie, essentially. It's like an OVA that was a tie-in to a doll, but there it is. Maho no Angel Sweet Mint, which is a magical girl show about just this magical witch girl who goes and helps people with their basic everyday problems. Trap Ika Monogatari, or Trap Family Story, which is about... It's an adaptation of the same book that The Sound of Music was adapted from, and this one also has a sort of tomboyish girl protagonist who, you know, who is not traditionally feminine. Oni-sama E, which takes place in an all-girls school, and I think is like a Yuri-ish type show. Yawara, which is about the judo girl, this girl who's amazing at judo and kicks everybody's ass. And even Ranma One Half, where the main character is a guy who turns into a girl, and most of the girls in the story can kick any normal person's ass. It's full of kick-ass girls. So just in general, the late 80s and early 90s were a time when anime girls kicked lots of ass. And they were usually in charge. And they usually were the protagonist. And I think that's interesting because this couldn't have happened by accident. It could happen by coincidence. I'm not saying this was a concentrated effort on the part of the anime industry to only make shows about girls who kick ass. And I'm sure part of it was trendy. Sure, certainly there were some popular shows that everyone was trying to copy or something like that. Nasuka of the Valley of the Wind was really popular around this time. Everyone wants to have their Nasuka. Everyone wants to have their Gunbuster. But for this to happen, it's a cultural movement. Like, there's just no other way about it. This is like 80% of the fucking shows that aired in 1991 were about kick-ass girls, most of whom don't end up in romantic relationships or end up needing to be saved by guys like they would in a lot of modern shows. No one's necessarily having to be paired up at the end of the show. It's just fun slice-of-life shows some of the time, or just shows about girls kicking ass in the everyday. They're superheroes, like any other superhero. And I wonder what caused this, because I don't know. There's no way to say for sure. Maybe it was something to do with Japanese culture's movement at the time. Japan has always been known for not having the best equal rights for women. They still have a lot of problems with not enough women in the workplace, not enough women taking charge and living alone and not being able to raise a kid and go to work at the same time. There's a lot of issues. I'll link some articles about that in the description, like some of the problems that are still being faced by women in Japanese society. But was that what inspired this? Was it partly trying to be uplifting towards women? Or was it partly a commentary on how people wanted women to be treated or for them to act? I mean, a lot of these shows were written by guys, I'm sure, if not most of them, probably. And I wonder what those guys were trying to say in writing these works. Were they trying to inspire women to get into anime and get into the industry? Or was it just because cute girls kicking ass is cool? Was that just what guys were into at the time? Clearly some of these shows were made with a male audience in mind, but were all of them about just, hey, here's cute girls doing cool shit? Like, what was it? What caused this? I don't know, but it's fascinating to know that it happened, and that it's such a unique period in anime history that it was so saturated with this kind of show. And I'd love to see it happen again, because a lot of these 90s shows, this was not a great time for anime in general, I don't think. Even though it had so many cool female protagonists and cool things going on, this was in general not a great period for storytelling and stuff like that in animation, because most shows were either really short OVAs that were incomplete or just didn't have much of a story because they were so small, or they were kids' shows. There wasn't a lot of the TV anime we get today, where you get the 13 to 26 to 50 episode shows that really have time to flesh out their narratives. Not a lot of that in 1991 anime. But how cool would it be for a resurgence of this, where we actually got to see characters who were not just cool women kicking ass, but cool, well-developed, fleshed-out, memorable women kicking ass. I think we have a lot of cool, memorable, well-fleshed-out female characters now, but they're not as common, not as densely packed. There's way more shows about guys kicking ass. So I thought this was interesting. I spent all month watching all these fucking shows to present this. I hope some of you found it interesting too. I'm sorry I don't have any conclusions to come to, and I hope that by doing this as a sort of unscripted ramble, I could take you down this road with me and sort of just let you experience things the way I did and see where I'm coming from here and why this interested me, because it is totally pointless. Thanks again for watching. If you enjoyed this video and you'd like to help me to produce more content like this, please support me on Patreon, because I can't do a lot of big projects like this. It's not very financially viable. I don't make enough money on Patreon to spend all month on one video like I just did. I have another video coming out of this. And the videos I put out this month were all direct results of this research. I watched Only Yesterday and Legend of Galactic Heroes because they aired in 1991. But, the more support I have, the more I can spend time on big, interesting projects, at least interesting to me. So if this was interesting to you, then please support me. If it wasn't, then don't, and I'll take that as a hint that I need to just go back to making small videos that don't take a lot of research. Thanks again for watching. I'll see you in the next one.